are a child. I was only six when it started, and all my memories of my grandfather are muddled up with Doctor Who, because I probably saw him more often on the screen than I did in real life, in a way. So as a child, you don't know anything different. I came from a theatrical family. All the family had been in the industry, my father as well. So it didn't seem unusual. It sort of seemed normal, if you can understand that. Well, I stayed with my grandmother quite a bit when I was little, because my brother was younger than me. So I used to stay at my grandparents' house. I don't remember how often that was, but I did stay for days at a time, and I loved staying there, mostly with my grandmother, occupied with my grandmother. But then, of course, I saw him every Saturday on television for 3 years. So that's how much I saw him then. And of course, if I went and stayed with my grandmother during the shooting of Doctor Who, he would not often be there. If it was during the week, he would be in London rehearsing and recording the show. And if it happened to be at a weekend, then he would have been very quiet and learning lines and things like that. So I honestly don't remember as a child how often I saw him, I'm afraid. But going on set was great fun. I have to look at the book to remind me, I was about seven anyway. And I remember going up to London, I think with my father, and he took me to the studios. I can't remember now without looking back for reference whether it was Riverside Studios or something like that, but I have very, very clear memories of being very excited and feeling very grown up, and sitting in the dressing room with my grandfather, or the makeup room with my grandfather, when he was being made up, and watching them do the wig. And I remember a makeup girl making a bruise on my arm, making it a pretend bruise on my arm, which I was terribly proud of and thought it was rather exciting. Then I remember going on set. I remember all the cables everywhere, because it wasn't a big room. And I remember seeing some of the ant costumes just lying at the side, and how heavy and cumbersome they looked to me. I also remember being shown a studio room, a small studio room, where there was a heap of sand and a little TARDIS on the top. And it was for one of the few cutaways there were at that time. And I remember thinking how little it looked. And of course, when you saw the final thing cut into the episode, it looked perfectly normal. But it was very interesting seeing that as a child, and I had to try and keep out of the way when they were shooting. So it was all very exciting. Yes, he was very good at appreciating his fans. I think he thought it was important. He did things even before Doctor Who. He would do fan signings and events. And in the 40s, I think it was, he had a fan club where he did interviews and had members of his fan club and things like that. He was always good at that. He did do work schedule permitting, because obviously they did 48 weeks a year, and I don't know, he might have had a little bit of time off in them, but you know, it was a hard slog week in, week out. But he did, I know he, I've seen his references to the fact that he went to an air show, which he absolutely adored. He opened a fete, which was at the village where I grew up. And he loved that, and he met lots of children there. He did do quite a lot of that, always permitting, work permitting, but he did do that and thought it was important and was very happy to do it and really quite proud of it. And I think he'd have been great at conventions. I think he'd have been absolutely thrilled by it. I decided to write the book because I was an actress at the time. So I had intermittent work, and I did temp jobs and things like that around it. And people had written to my mother asking her questions about him. There had been a couple of published sections in Doctor Who books about my grandfather, most of which were based on interviews he'd given, other articles that had been written about him, and some of them, quite frankly, weren't quite true. Because he was ashamed of his childhood, he'd invented a background, and some of them weren't quite consistent. He was the son of a businessman, he was the son of this person or that person, grew up in various places which weren't exactly the truth. So, and in fact, an American, I think, turned up on the doorstep of my father's office. My father was an agent, my father represented my grandfather. And someone around that time turned up on the doorstep and said he was going to write a biography of my grandfather and he wanted this, that and the other question to be answered. And my father told me this. My mother'd also received, I don't know if it was from the same person, a list of questions about him. So people were trying to write biographies of him. And my mother didn't know everything that I found out, and she really couldn't handle the idea. So I decided I'd do the research and write a biography. In fact, I started to do the research and then gave up because I think it was quite, I can't remember now, but it was quite close to when my grandmother died and my mum couldn't really deal with talking about it all then. So I let it lie for a little bit, picked it up 2 years later. I think that was after the person had turned up on the doorstep of the office. And I think it's then that I said, yes, I'm going to do it now. So I started the research. It was something I could do around odd acting jobs. I wrote to lots and lots of people who'd worked with him, met some of them. Sadly, one or two of the people that I'd intended to write to had died in the intervening 2 years, so I had missed out on one or two memories. But the whole process took quite a year or so, and then I wrote to several publishers with a treatment, with a sample chapter, and got it picked up by Virgin. My mother was his only child, and she didn't talk to him about his childhood. He didn't want to talk about his childhood. He was born at an era when being illegitimate was something shameful, so he didn't talk to her about it. My grandmother had died. I found boxes in the loft that my grandmother had left, which my mother had not gone through. So my mother had never seen the exercise book where he'd written up a lot of his early story. His mentor, who became his unofficial guardian, Hugh Blaker, had made him, as a teenager, he was 14 or 15, 14 when Hugh first met him, made him write up the story of his life. So I've got, I can't remember, 50 pages of handwritten story, which later on he wrote at the back, this is the story of my life. And that was fantastic to find. It was difficult to decipher. Some of it was very spidery handwriting. But it was the most amazing, history of his life. And I was able to use that and check all the facts in it and about where he lived and things like that. And then researching Hugh Blaker was also really interesting because Hugh Blaker was somewhat of a public figure. He was an artist, an art connoisseur, a critic. He'd run an art gallery. So, in fact, that was the other thing that was really interesting. I read an obit of him and then found he curated an art gallery in Bath, phoned the art gallery up and found, amazingly, serendipity really, that someone had just written a thesis on Hugh Blaker, which they gave me a copy of, or lent me a copy of, and I was able to learn so much about Hugh Blaker. I went to, I think it was Aberystwyth University, where the person had been working, where the thesis came from, and they curated an exhibition to do with Hugh Blaker, and there amongst the stuff there were a couple of sketches of my grandfather made when my grandfather was still about 14 in a boys club boxing. So it's fantastic to do serious research before the internet was a thing really, and join up all the dots. And so there was an awful lot that I found out that my mother didn't even know, which was very exciting. As a child, I knew nothing other than people who'd worked in the theatre, because my father had been an actor before he became an agent, and his parents were in the profession. although I never knew my grandparents on my father's side, they were music hall, and then my grandfather on my father's side went into films in the 30s, sort of about 10 years before William Hartnell did. And so I grew up on my father's anecdotes about the theatre and about his father, and my mother's anecdotes about her parents, who were actors when she was a child, and obviously about William Hartnell then. So in a way, I didn't know anything else, and it's such a distinctive profession. It's such a all-encompassing, all-embracing profession that I think it's all I wanted to do. Looking back, being an actor wasn't right for me, but I've been an agent for 22, 23 years, can't remember now, which has been great. Had I my time again, I might have done something different. I might have tried producing or something like that, but yeah, I don't think I knew about any other professions. I'm always slightly nervous being invited to these events because I feel I was never in Doctor Who. I'm not a Doctor Who expert. Most of the people who attend them are far more knowledgeable about Doctor Who than I am. However, I did write the book. I obviously am the granddaughter, and I feel very pleased that the programme and my grandfather's performance and starting the whole genre, as it were, almost, have made a lot of people very happy. And I'm really always pleased at how much pleasure it seems to give people, how much the programme means to people, and how much people still remember and talk about and think about my grandfather. So it's something he would have loved, and it's lovely to think that his performance started such a fantastic legacy of a programme that's gone on for years, with a gap, of course.